So next up is Aharon Haravon. This will be a very practically oriented lecture. So yeah, please stay tuned and close your laptops. Listen. Thanks.
Good luck. Okay, so hello there. My name is Aharon Haravon. I am a software engineer. I work at Israeli startup called Nuvo as a principal software architect and SRE lead. Nuvo develops remote pregnancy monitoring medical device. In this session, I will talk about horizontal pod autoscaling in Kubernetes. Let's start with a question. So is there anybody here who is already an autoscaling expert? Okay, I see some hands. Is there anybody here who doesn't know what a Kubernetes pod is? Well, I see a few hands as well. Okay, so but most of you already do know what a Kubernetes pod is, but are not autoscaling experts. So this session is mainly crafted for the majority people here, although there should be some takeaways for others that as well. Software should allow business to start small and grow later. Furthermore, at any given time, we only want to pay for the resources that are actually providing us some value. So in this talk, we will learn about the horizontal autoscaling of cloud-native applications, and we'll see the advantages of the open source project KEDA. I will gradually explain the basics and build on that on top of that, to cover some more advanced topics, and I will finish with the fine-tuning tips. So while the autoscaling beginners will learn many things right from the start, the patient experts in the area will have some valuable takeaways towards the lecture end. So the service SLA and the processing times have direct implications on the autoscaling requirements. Also, the autoscaling technology limitations may impose business constraints or limit our available cost-saving opportunities. So to succeed in designing cost-effective autoscaling solutions, we need to first get familiar with both the underlying technology and the use case that we are addressing. So horizontal autoscaling in modern applications involves interaction of four different systems. Each of these software components has its own role in making the magic work. We will closely examine the HPA controller, then learn a bit about the KEDA controller. Then we'll see some aspects of the cluster autoscaler and mention a few points about the AWS autoscaling groups. In other cloud vendors, there are equivalent services. So KEDA helps bring the metrics from the external world into the Kubernetes and creates this HPA object. HPA controller monitors the metrics according to the definition in the HPA object and reacts to its changes by adjusting the pod count in the scaled application. Cluster autoscaler, in turn, detects there are nodes that are missing or unneeded and adjusts the node count accordingly by talking to the cloud vendor's autoscaling infrastructure. Then the cloud vendor's autoscaling infrastructure provisions virtual machines or removes them. Okay, so the source of the metric for the HPA controller may be from one of the three supported APIs. Metrics API, custom metrics API, and external metrics API. None of these APIs is available in Kubernetes by default. So to have one or more of these APIs in the cluster, we need to provide additional software. Let's note here that the metrics API and custom metrics API metrics relate to Kubernetes entities, such as pods, nodes, ingresses, and such. The external, while the external metrics API metrics relate to external entities. Okay, so the metrics API provides CPU and memory utilization for the nods and the pods. If your horizontal autoscaling strategy is well defined in those terms, then you do not need the KEDA scaler. All you need in this case is the Kubernetes metrics API, which metrics server, I'm sorry, that implements this metrics API. So in many cases, autoscaling is not well defined in terms of CPU and memory. For example, you may want to fully utilize your resources, like virtual machines, for each unit of workload. In such cases, setting some threshold for utilization of your virtual machine is inappropriate. So when your autoscaling strategy is well-defined based on a metric that relates to a Kubernetes resource, for example, pod or ingest, like requests per second handled by a pod, then you may want to use a custom metrics API. One way to add custom metrics API support to our cluster is to implement our own custom metrics server. The function of this program is to feed the Kubernetes through this custom metrics API values of our application-specific metrics. So, the obvious disadvantage of this approach is that we need to implement yet another software component that has to be versioned, maintained, tested, and so on. Another challenge is that, as of today, there can be only one custom metrics server in a Kubernetes cluster. So this means that we would need to implement all of the scraping of all the metrics, not just from our application, but from infrastructure and all the other applications in this single piece of code. This may turn out to be not feasible and definitely doesn't sound like much fun. Yeah? So another option is that we expose on a REST endpoint our application-specific metric in open metric standard format. And then we add Prometheus to our cluster that will collect and store these metrics. And then we need also Prometheus adapter that will bridge between, that will expose this data in the Prometheus in the custom metrics API. Okay, the challenges with this solution is that Prometheus adapter configuration is somewhat complex. Also, it introduces interdependence between the teams because there is only one Prometheus adapter in the cluster, and it's usually responsibility of the SRE team. And on the other hand, there are many different application developers. So the application developer is not independent when defining the autoscaling for their own service. Another challenge is that the observability stack component, Prometheus, becomes critical for your application function, which is not so obvious. So this is where KEDA jumps in. Okay, so in many times, the metrics your application should scale upon can be represented by a property of a middleware system, like a message broker or a state of your database or similar. In those cases, we do not need to implement any metrics for the purpose of autoscaling. We can just configure KEDA, and its configuration is very simple. It also streamlines the development process as the developers remain independent when defining the autoscaling for their own service. It also leaves the observability stack component Prometheus outside of the critical execution path. So not that there is something wrong with Prometheus, it's just a kind of violation of separation of concern principle to me, in my view, to have observability stack component performing some critical function. Okay, KEDA does its magic with the out-of-the-box integrations with multitude of middleware systems, message brokers, databases, and so on. The function of these integrations is to bring the metrics from the external system into this external metrics API that Kubernetes can use to scale your application. Those integrations are called KEDA scalers. But what if our application metrics that we need to scale our application is not a simple derivative of a property of an external system? Can we still somehow leverage KEDA in this case? Those that are experts, anyone know? I think I hear yes here, so yes. You can still leverage KEDA in this case in two ways. You can use the Prometheus scaler that will actually read the metrics from the Prometheus and therefore still have all the advantages of KEDA, or most of the advantages, and skip the disadvantages of Prometheus adapter that I mentioned earlier, or you can opt in for metrics API scaler that will skip Prometheus altogether and directly query your service endpoint to retrieve the metrics. Okay, so we've seen the three different APIs that we can implement to have auto-scaling of our application, and we've seen the advantage of the KEDA. So now let's learn a bit about this HPA object that is like the configuration for the HPA controller to scale our application. So this is like, it has five fields, minimum and maximum replicas, define the range within which our application will be scaled, like how many pods should be minimum, how many maximum. Scale target reference is just pointer, like which application should be scaled. Metrics is an array of metrics that we want the scaling to be based upon. And behavior is a field that contains some fine tuning for this scaling. So in this example, we have this YAML actually defines CPU-based auto-scaling. So we say here that we want 50% on average utilization of the CPU across all of the containers in all the pods. When defining auto-scaling based on the CPU utilization or memory utilization, you need to make sure to also declare the resource requests, because without this 50% is not defined. It's 50% of the resource requests. Okay, so in this example, we see an HPA object that will scale the application, the service, based on the RabbitMQ queue length. So we can notice that it has all the required fields, minimum, maximum replicas, the metrics field that points to a metric, and the scale target reference is, in this case, demo service. Okay, so the metrics array is an array. Obviously, it can have more than one element. And the metric that yields the largest number of replicas will have an effect. Okay, so now the metric type is a field that defines the kindness of this metric. So there are five kinds. So there is container resource and resource, which is actually used for the metrics from the metrics API, for the CPU and memory metrics. So it's either for containers or for pods, the resources for pods. So custom metrics API types are pods and objects. Pods are for those custom metrics that relate to pods, and objects for all the other Kubernetes entities related metrics. And external metrics API has only one external metric type associated. Okay, so target type can have one of the three possible values: utilization, value, and average value. Utilization is used for the CPU and memory, the metrics API metrics, and the value and average value I'll use for the rest. So each of these metric types and target types, like combination, actually fine-tunes the calculation for the desired number of replicas of our application. But in general, this is the formula. So in general, HPA controller calculates the number of the desired replicas as the smallest number, not smaller than the multiplication of the current number of replicas, and the ratio of the current metric value over the desired metric value. The desired metric value is actually also called sometimes threshold or target value. It's all interchangeable terms in this context. So the devil is usually in the details. So although there is this simple formula, there are differences depending on the metric type and the target type, how this is calculated. So if you will ever need to dive deeper into how it's working, then you should check out these particular files in the Kubernetes repository that encapsulate this logic. Mm. Okay, I will mention here because KEDA is using external metrics, external type of the metric type, and it can have these two target types, average value and value. So I'll explain a bit the difference. So we use the average value target type when our metric is not already averaged. So for example, message queue length. And we use value target type when the metric is already averaged by the external system. For example, average milliseconds a message spends in the queue. So it's already averaged, so the HPA controller should not average it, and therefore we use the target type value. Okay, so this is the behavior field. This is the structure that is kept in the behavior field. We need to specify it only if it differs from this default behavior. And basically it has these policies for scale down and scale up. This is well documented. You can easily get familiar with it. So HPA controller fine-tuning parameters come from the command line parameters for the kube controller manager. That is the process that hosts all the Kubernetes controllers. So it has many, many command line parameters, and this is even only those that fine-tune the HPA controller. There is like, I don't know, maybe 30 of them. So I just selected these to draw your attention to first look at them when fine-tuning your solution. So I'll mention here that the horizontal pod autoscaler sync period is the frequency of those evaluations. So the default is 15 seconds, and you should reduce it to 1 second if you want your scale ups and scale downs to be quicker, to react quicker according to the changes in the metric. Okay, let's now learn about the SCADA object CLD, scaled object CLD, that is the configuration of the KEDA. So let's just remember that KEDA will look at this into this scaled object CLD and automatically create for us this HPA object that is the configuration for the HPA controller. So and it also exposes this external metrics in the Kubernetes external metrics API. So this is all we need to add to our application, this small YAML, in order to have it scaled based on, to have our service scaled based on the RabbitMQ queue length. So we can see that this configuration has all the fields that we mentioned earlier in the HPA object definition. So it has this minimum and maximum replicas and scale target reference, that is the name of the application that we are scaling. And it also, now instead of metrics, here we have triggers, which is basically equivalent of metrics, but here we are not only referencing a metric, but we are defining the metric. This is like the configuration for the source of the metric. So the type RabbitMQ, it means that we want to use the RabbitMQ SCADA scaler, and The metadata will, of course, section will differ from scalar to scalar, and this is like the configuration of what we want to read from this particular external system, in this case, RabbitMQ. So here we say we want to read the queue length of the particular queue name, demo service, and we want the target value to be 1. In addition to these fields that we already noticed from the HPA object, we have also a metric type field. We can have a metric type field defined on the trigger, which will surprisingly keep the target type and not the metric type, which is kind of confusing, and I opened the ticket for this, and they agreed to change it in the next release. It will be called target type. But for now, it's called metric type, and the default is average value. Usually, the target type average value is most common option, so it's a default here, and we don't need to mention it at all. KEDA also performs the scale down to 0. HPA controller doesn't do that, but the KEDA will scale down your service to 0 also if you set the minimum replica count to 0. So the cooldown period is the time it will wait before doing this last scale down step from 1 to 0. Okay, and the polling interval is, again, it's a frequency, how often KEDA will poll this external metric, and the default is, I think, 10 seconds, so you may want to reduce it down to 1 second to have faster reaction to the changes in the metric. All right, so we've covered different metrics APIs. We've seen why KEDA and external metrics API is the way to go. We've learned about the HPA object field and the scaled object field, and we learned about the difference between the average value and the value target type. Now, let's see a bit about the cluster autoscaler. So as we mentioned, cluster autoscaler detects that pods are lacking some resources like CPU and memory in order to be scheduled somewhere. And then it, in turn, will talk with the cloud vendor infrastructure to ask it to bring in some more nodes. Likewise, it can detect that some node is utilized below the configured threshold, and it will just tear this node. It will take it out because it's underutilized. So this is the function of the cluster autoscaler. Okay, the important parameters I want you to first tune are those. Okay, it has also many command line parameters, but these are the most effective ones. Scan interval is, again, the frequency of evaluations of how many nodes should be there in the cluster. And the default of 10 seconds should be reduced again to 1 to have faster scale outs and scale downs. Okay, so the cloud vendor infrastructure is in AWS, it's called AWS Autoscaling Groups, and it has many advanced features, like, I don't know, like scheduled scalings and the predictive scaling. But when used in combination with the cluster autoscaler, it works in the manual mode, meaning we cannot use these advanced features. Luckily, KEDA comes with equivalent scalers for those functionalities. So we can use crontab scaler to have schedule scalings, and we can use predict cube scaler to have predictive scalings based on machine learning from the past. So basically, we can have, with KEDA, we can have these features implemented in a cloud vendor agnostic way. Okay, so provisioning a virtual machine in the cloud is obviously not an instant operation. It takes some time to provision, to boot, to install all the required software and configure and then join this machine to the cluster. So to reduce the total time required to join the node to the cluster, AWS ASG provides feature called warm pools. This feature, actually, what it does is it pre-launches a nodes. It pre-launches them before they are really actually needed, and then runs this launch template scripts, which are preparing the node, installing everything, configuring, and then it shutdowns these machines. In the meanwhile, we only pay for the disks, which is far cheaper than paying for instances in the air. And then once their nodes are needed, they're just quickly joined to the cluster, and therefore this makes our solution much more cost effective. So make sure to test your auto-scaling setups. Okay, this is an important step. When testing it, you may want to simulate your load peaks and measure the timings for different events of the flow of the initialization, like pods when created, instances booted, nodes created, and so on, until the pod is ready, scheduled and ready. So this is the results of a test that I have performed on an application that was scaled based on a RabbitMQ queue length. So I submitted 20 items for processing, and each item requires one pod, and each pod requires one node. So this is like some situation I was addressing. And you can see that without any tunings with the defaults for everything, we get this kind of timing. So we have pods created somewhere between 0 and 50 seconds. And then, yeah, all the different initialization stages occur, and the pod becomes ready somewhere between 140 and 250 seconds. This was really far from what I was hoping to achieve. So I went on and I fine-tuned some parameters. I started by fine-tuning the behavior, this field in the HPA, and also it exists in the scaled object CLD. So by tuning only this, I already got significant improvement. We can see that the pods are created simultaneously, and we can see that the pods become ready somewhere between 140 and 180 seconds. This was still not good enough for me. I wanted to achieve a situation where I could get pods in 60 seconds, get pod ready in 60 seconds. This is because this medical device that expectant mother is mounting, like I know like 1 minute in advance that I will need this strong machine that is very expensive. So if I could get pod ready in 60 seconds, I wouldn't have to keep many expensive machines online just to be able to handle some load peak. So I fine-tuned all the parameters that I mentioned earlier. I also used the warm pools feature, and I even pre-pooled all the images that will be used, the container images, and I achieved this, which was exactly what I was hoping to achieve, meaning that I saved like enormous amount of money for the company because, yeah, we don't have to keep this headroom, so-called headroom that is really expensive and doing nothing. So I hope that this inspires you to also fine-tune your own setups for the auto-scaling. Okay, so there are, of course, many other things that are relevant for auto-scaling that were not mentioned here, like pod priority and preemption effects, pod volumes effects, and other open source cluster autoscalers like Carpenter and so forth. But you can already, you know, build some stuff with this, what you've learned, and you can take on from here and learn more. Of course, I also created a GitHub repository that will help you try this all out and actually reproduce the charts that I just showed earlier. With some, I don't know, there is the COPS and the Terraform and the two services in Python that emulate some kind of workload. And then there is also some shell scripts to extract the timings of different events that I mentioned earlier. Okay, so these are the sources for the images I've used. You can reach me in this email, and thank you for your attention.